We'll mute everyone.
Okay.
The Lord be with you. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. And here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my. Altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. I never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I never know how much it cost to see sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, together worthy,
sacrifice of God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart God will not despise. Let us come to the Lord who is full of compassion and acknowledge our transgressions in penitence and faith. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been, help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Holy God, you know the disorder of our sinful lives. Set straight our crooked hearts and bend our wills to love your goodness and your glory. In Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us access to his grace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Vera, you'll need to unmute yourself.
The Old Testament reading is taken from the second book of Kings, chapter 2, verses 1 to 12. Elijah ascends to heaven. When the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven in a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, the Lord has sent me to Bethel." But Elisha said, "As surely as the Lord lives, and as you live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of the prophets at Bethel came out to Elisha and asked, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today?" "Yes, I know," Elisha replied, "so be quiet." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, Elisha, the Lord has sent me to Jericho." And he replied, "As surely as the Lord lives, and as you live, I will not leave you." So they went to Jericho. The company of the prophets at Jericho went up to Elisha and asked him, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today?" "Yes, I know," he replied, "so be quiet." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here. The Lord has sent me to the Jordan." And he replied, "As surely as the Lord lives, and as you live, I will not leave you." So the two of them walked on. 50 men from the company of the prophets went and stood at a distance, facing the place where Elijah and Elisha had stopped at the Jordan. Elijah took his cloak, rolled it up, and struck the water with it. The water divided to the right and to the left, and the two of them crossed over on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me, what can I do for you before I am taken from you? Let me inherit a double portion of your spirit," Elisha replied. "You have asked a difficult thing," Elijah said. "Yet if you see me when I am taken from you, it will be yours. Otherwise, it will not." As they were walking along and talking together, suddenly a chariot of fire and horses of fire appeared and separated the two of them. And Elijah went up to heaven in a whirlwind. Elisha saw this and cried out, "My father, my father, the chariots and horsemen of Israel." And Elisha saw him no more. Then he took hold of his garment and tore it in two. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Vera. So we read these verses from Psalm 50 together. The Lord, the most mighty God, has spoken and called the world from the rising of the sun to its setting. Out of Zion, perfect in beauty, God shines forth. Our God comes and will not keep silence. Consuming fire goes out before him, and a mighty tempest stirs about him. He calls the heaven above and the earth, that he may judge his people. Gather to me my faithful, who have sealed my covenant with sacrifice. Let the heavens declare his righteousness, for God himself is judge. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Thank you, Lynn.
The New Testament reading is from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 to 6. Therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we preach is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Jenny.
Gospel reading is taken from the Gospel according to St. Mark. Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to Christ, our Savior.
After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There, he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, they were so frightened. Then a cloud appeared and covered them, and a voice came from the cloud, "This is my son whom I love. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them except Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they'd seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We set a tremendous store on first impressions. We can't really help it. It's all part of the human condition. That first impression may be based upon something as small as a name or something about the visual appearance. Every so often, these first impressions catch us out. The accent of the speaker isn't what we expect. The story in the paper doesn't reflect the reality. Or the book's contents don't match the cover. One thing that's encouraging about the disciples is how long it takes them to work out what's going on with Jesus, who he is, what his mission is. And if you remember that the first gospel wasn't even written until 20 to 30 years after the first Easter, it gives you some idea of how long it really took them to piece together how this extraordinary man, Jesus, could also be God himself. Everyone has insights, experiences wherein the veil of ordinariness is briefly rolled back and we see into an object or a person or an event. We see it or him or her or them in a way we've never seen before. We see them in a broader context than what maybe others seeing the same things do not see. We might really see the beauty of a flower we'd looked at 100 times before, but now it's its extraordinariness that we grasp. We may see the truth of something or someone, a truth that up until then has eluded us. We may say the goodness of a person or an event, a goodness often others may not see, but actually see as bad. And all these experiences are insights into reality without the external appearances of the reality actually being changed. The change takes place in the person who's doing the perceiving. Jesus was transfigured. Or transformed. The Greek is metamorphosis. It refers to a whole change of being, and it was for the benefit of the disciples. Certainly, the transfiguration scene was an insight, but it was more than that. The disciples all had the same experience at the same time. While an insight into the real Jesus, it was also a physical vision. Jesus changed before their physical eyes and not merely their faith eyes. They would have been able to ask each other, "Did you see that?" and get the same answer. This was an experience at the physical level, at the level of earth, time, space. Yet at the same time, it was also a spiritual one, one that entered and affected their inner beings. Great as it was, it didn't last. They got a glimpse of glory, a preview of the resurrected life, but only for a brief minute. Alas, they would have to come down from this mountain experience and live once again on the molehill of the ordinariness of the world. Mountain experiences, religious experiences, aesthetic experience, truth experience can't be conjured up. There's no known method to produce them. They're gifts that are given to us at the moment, but they can be remembered. They can help us to know intuitively the glory hidden in the ordinary and help to bring it out. We sometimes pray to God to reveal himself visibly, to confirm our trust by a visibly, emotionally felt sign. This story teaches us that even if he did, and he sometimes does, it wouldn't make much difference. If we have a mountain experience, remembering it will make a difference. It will strengthen our faith, our resolve, as it enables us to see the end point. When the disciples came down the mountain and re-entered ordinariness, they came back to earth with a bump. The vision was gone, but Jesus was still present. Same glorious reality they experienced on the mountain is present on the molehill, just as real and potentially powerful. So it is with us. The Transfiguration, like all truly religious experience, is both a real event and anticipation of future glory. In this case, it's an anticipation of the resurrection glory of Jesus, including our share in it. It provided these three most intimate friends of Jesus with a glimpse of the not yet historically risen Lord to help them get through the upcoming rough days. As a revelation of the hidden quality of Jesus' life, the Transfiguration was a guarantee not only of later glory, but also of the present quality and strength of their own lives, when Jesus would be raised and would leave his spirit with them. Peter clearly had a vivid recollection of the transfiguration of Jesus when he wrote his second letter. We did not follow cleverly invented stories when we told you about the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses to his majesty. We ourselves heard the voice that came down from heaven when we were with him on the sacred mountain. The instant clearly had a profound effect upon Peter. It showed the true majesty and glory of Jesus that was hidden by his humanity. The Transfiguration would also have inspired the disciples when things were difficult. You can almost imagine Peter, James, and John encouraging one another with their recollection of the event as they were being persecuted. This story reveals the majesty of Jesus. I think sometimes we might focus too much on his humanity, because there's a danger of relegating Jesus to being little more than a good man, of being too familiar with him or as seeing him as a friend without remembering that he is God as well. The Transfiguration reminds us that hidden within that human frame was the glory, the splendor, and the majesty of God. And this should lead us to fear, wonder, and to stand in awe, It should encourage us towards self-examination, to realise how our filthy rags contrast with the shining white of his garments of righteousness and faith and truth. He deserves our honour, our praise, our worship and wholehearted dedication. When we help out at the church, live out or share our faith, we're not doing it for the vicar or for the church or for ourselves, but for the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Martin Luther King described his mountaintop experiences in his most famous sermon entitled, I See the Promised Land. Martin Luther King said that he didn't worry about anything because he'd been to the mountaintop with God. He said he had no fear, for my eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. The next day, Martin Luther King was shot dead. But that night when he preached, Dr. King was ready to face his destiny. He was ready to face the future because he'd been to the mountaintop with the Lord. That's what mountaintop experiences in our lives are all about. To help us to get ready for the tomorrows. They help us face the future in hope and assurance that God is there with us. But mountaintop experiences also prepare us for the valleys in our lives. We're able to make it through the valleys in our lives because, like Martin Luther King, we've been to the mountaintop with God. When we're in the valley of joblessness, in the valley of loneliness, in the valley of sickness, in the valley of depression, in the darkest of all valleys, the valley of the shadow of death, we shall fear no evil, for the Lord is with us. We need to remember our mountaintop experiences and remember that just as God was with us up on the mountaintop, God is with us in the valleys of our lives. As followers and disciples of Jesus, we may experience rejection, suffering, and persecution. Like Moses, like Elijah, like Jesus, and like Christians throughout history. And one of the things that we can comfort ourselves with is that there's something more and better to come. In the ordinariness of the molehills of life, we need to hang on to and remember our mountaintop experiences. And like the three disciples, we can encourage each other in difficult times. We may not have had the same mountaintop experience as someone else, but remembering them can be comforting when you're in the depths of the darkest valley. The appearance of Jesus in his glory reminds us that we will receive spiritual, glorified bodies like his, and no longer be subject to pain, illness, suffering, and death. Because the old order of things will have passed away. Then we shall be in the presence of Jesus, God the Father, and God the Holy Spirit for eternity. Amen.
Thank you, Jenny. Let us profess the faith of the Church. We believe in one God, Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We pray for the church and for the world. Lord, in these times of worry, strain and stress, we pray for all the peoples of the world. We pray for all those facing oppression and injustice at a time when such issues are less front and centre in our minds, as the media remains primarily focused on the COVID narrative. We pray specifically for the peoples of Belarus, Myanmar, Chinese Muslims, and those trapped in another pointless conflict in Ethiopia. Lord, ensure that the world does not turn a blind eye to these situations. Empower those in authority in all countries to challenge the regimes responsible publicly, keeping pressure on the perpetrators to change course and stop hurting their fellow citizens. Lord, we give thanks for the remarkable progress being made in the huge task of vaccinating the UK population against COVID. We thank you for the skills and energy of all those involved. Keep them safe as they go about their life-saving work. We pray for the church, both here in the UK and worldwide. May it be a beacon to the world, supplying support and help whenever it can. Help us to remember that we're all members of this vast entity and therefore key parts of your interaction with the world, and by your grace, channels of your purpose. We give thanks for all the acts of kindness and grace that are going on daily in your world, knowing that the sum of them and the light they bring vastly exceeds the acts of darkness. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for our families and friends and neighbours. Give grace to our families and friends and to all whom we have contact in our daily lives, remembering your teaching that everyone is our neighbour. A prayer for our neighbours. Lord, we thank thee that our fellow men and women, without whom we have no personal relationship and on whose work we depend for the continuation of our lives. Let us always respect them, never try to exploit them, always be open to them, never presuming to classify them, but always be reverent in their mystery and selfhood. Let our hearts go out to greet them, let the smile of our eyes welcome them, in a desire for true relationship, O Father of us both. We pray for all of those who continue to find lockdown extremely difficult. We hope that they may receive the support they need and have the strength to reach out for help when needed. Help us to stay aware and to be proactive in our efforts to assist when we can. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, comfort those and heal those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. In these difficult times, it is easy to slip into a mindset where disease other than COVID features in our thinking, a sort of subconscious game of disease top trumps. Help us to remember, Lord, the many that are quietly coping with all other ailments and conditions. Make us supportive and open to all who are ill, including those who are suffering from depression and mental illness, often not asking for help as they feel guilty in these times when resources are stretched. Strengthen all those whose work it is to preserve life and heal the sick. We give thanks for the NHS. May the desire to support it go beyond the current crisis and reshape government priorities in the future, ensuring that we do not slip back into a selfish business as usual mindset. Let us, in a moment of silence, lift up those who we know are sick or troubled at this time. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those who have died and for those who mourn them. It used to be said that the Victorians were obsessed with death and brushed sex under the carpet, and the modern world was obsessed with sex and brushed death under the carpet. If true, COVID has changed that. To those with faith in you, death may be easier to bear, but for those who have never given it a second thought, there is just shock and a feeling of abandonment. Lord, comfort those who are going through the confusion and pain the bereavement brings. Help them to know that they are not alone and to lean on you at this time. Some words from Blandin. Going home. I've seen death too often to believe in death. It is not an ending, but a withdrawal. As one who finishes a long journey, stills the motor, turns off the lights, steps from the car, and walks up the path to the home that awaits him. In a moment of silence, Let us lift to God those who we know have been recently bereaved. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of our Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Before the Lord's Prayer, a prayer for this Racial Justice Sunday. Sovereign Lord Jesus Christ, who took human form and broke down the walls that divide, we seek your forgiveness for not living out the truth that all are one in Christ, for the sin of racism. We pray for all those affected by the marginalization of prejudice and the violence of racist words and actions. We pray that we might uproot its cancerous and systemic hold on our own institutions. We pray that we might recognize in reverence your divine image and likeness in our neighbor, and find joy in the resemblance. We pray in your name and seeking your glory. Amen. So let us pray with confidence as our Savior has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Anna. So there are your notices for the week ahead, and the only change really is that on Wednesday we don't have the Bible study with Andy Wooding Jones. That's taking a break, but Wednesday is at Wednesday, and so we will have a service of evening worship on Wednesday beginning at 7:30 p.m. I posted in the WhatsApp group a card produced by another parish with some suggestions about how you might observe Ash Wednesday, and included some instructions for making your own ash. I need to give you a very important amendment to those instructions. If you do choose to make your own ash, to ash yourself on Ash Wednesday, do not mix the ash with water. Mix it with oil, olive oil ideally, but not water. If the ash turns white and you mix it with water, then it may produce a chemical reaction which burns skin. So please do not mix it with water, and I'll put that correction out through email and the WhatsApp group as well. But if you want to make your own ash and have that ready for Wednesday, then please do. If you don't want to, that's fine. It's not essential. Do join us, please, on Wednesday evening, if you can. Thanks, Diana. Let's just be quiet for a moment. Almighty Father, whose Son was revealed in majesty before he suffered death upon the cross, give us grace to perceive his glory, that we may be strengthened to suffer with him, and be changed into his likeness, from glory to glory, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Christ, give you grace to grow in holiness. Deny yourselves, take up your cross, and follow him. and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and with all whom you love, now and always. Amen. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.